They were reformers in intention and wish, as well as being philosophers. And when the question is a big policy of reform, of course, philosophical clear-headedness is a help and not a hindrance.
That's true. And I saw another thing is this, is that I think on the whole, philosophers are temperamentally people who are less afraid of saying things which are unpopular or odd or ridiculous. I mean, we're always saying things which anybody who was not interested or acquainted with philosophy would think quite ridiculous.
Yes.
Or the raising problems that they would think quite ridiculous. And I should have thought that it was not so much a result of doing philosophy, but part of the temperament which made Miller a philosopher was also reflected in his willingness to express big, unpopular, reforming opinions.
Yes.
Without trying to cover them up.
What I'm trying to get at is what do you think, say, the student coming to philosophy may reasonably expect of his doing philosophy in terms of other kinds of problems which he's worried about. I'm thinking of a remark of Stanley Cavell's saying that the issues which one gets involved in when one has been doing philosophy for some time are very often, of course, not the issues which brought one to philosophy in the first place.
Pardon me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, for example, are you interested in teaching your pupils only to do what they're doing, the philosophy that you're teaching them, well, or do you think that you can have some other kind of influence on them? Would you hope to have some other kind of influence on them?
Well, of course, any teacher, particularly if he's doing tutorial teaching, as distinct from only lecturing teaching, acquires something of an avuncular attitude towards his pupils. Oh, and he's very grieved if they break their legs, and not for philosophical or chemical reasons. But I don't think that's what you're asking, whether philosophy tutors care about the general welfare, interests, pursuits, etc. of their pupils.
No, I'm asking something else. Yep. I'm asking about whether you think philosophy can actually be of benefit in some moral sense.
Well, the answer that you would like me to give is yes, so I'm going to give the answer no.
Well, could you explain why you think the answer you'd like, that I'd like you to give is yes, and then explain why?
Well, because you really want me, this is to go back to a previous point which I think Jim answered very well. You really want to say, there's no point in studying philosophy unless you can point to some dividends of a non-philosophic sort. Not, of course, cash dividends, but dividends in the way of becoming more virtuous, or becoming more happy, or becoming more inspired to write poems or plays or something of the sort. Well, I don't want to say that the point of studying philosophy is to get dividends.
You immediately put me in mind of Wittgenstein's remark that there's a therapeutic aspect to philosophy. Getting clear about something.
Yes.
Not even in that sense?
Oh, getting clear, certainly.
What's the value of getting clear?
What's the value of getting truth?
Well, you're the philosopher, I'm asking you.
Well, I'm saying the value of getting clear is the same as the value of getting truth, as opposed to remaining in error or darkness.
The getting clear, if you like, getting clear when it's a puzzle, clearly this is, if you like, an aim of philosophy. But the getting clear is the solution of a problem. It is not an external thing, what I would call a dividend, something which comes through the post as an extra. It's you're doing the thing for its own sake. And as wisdom ones, you said, mentioned wisdom, Wittgenstein saying the aim is to get clear. Well, of course, wisdom once pointed out that if you wanted to stop being philosophically puzzled, there was always the possibility of taking drugs. That if you took sufficient drugs, you would cease being philosophically puzzled, which, of course, the answer is, but you don't want to stop being puzzled that way. What you want to do is to solve the problems which are before you for their own sake.
But some of the problems which are before you are problems which relate to the way you relate to the world, as opposed to being, say, purely logical problems. And that presumably The point of solving those is in order to be able to relate to the world better.
Well, in a way, but Nelson, you see, supposing, let's take two very extreme and both probably rather ridiculous views that have been put forward in philosophy of the morals. As some people have said that when something is good, that this is for it to have something which is called a non-natural property. That is to say, it has some feature which you discern with the moral eye or some other inward eye, a kind of invisible paint, if you like, and this is what it is for something to be good. Other people have said that to say that something is good is rather like saying hurrah for it. It's to give vent to your emotions, to cheer or something like that, nothing more intellectual than that. Very well, but what does difference does this make practically? I mean, in other words, you find some people who say that something good is merely to vent their emotions, nonetheless engage in serious moral crusades, and you find some people who say that goodness is a non-natural quality, engaged in moral crusades. You find some people who hold these two views who are morally very ordinary, slack, not too conscientious individuals too. I don't think that the kind of inquiries that one traditionally, and not merely in modern Oxford, has done in moral philosophy are the sort which do go with it. If one gets the answer, I don't, whatever answer one gives, I don't think it affects your moral status in regard to the world.
First of all, you talked a bit earlier about Mill and made some reflections on his position in society, loss of religion and so forth. Could you perhaps make some similar reflections on your own status? Are you a religious person? If not, why not? How does this
relate? No, totally irreligious. I was brought up in the I was going to call it the creed of total agnosticism, and have never departed from it since. What's more, this wasn't even a worried or tortured loss of faith, because I never had it. My father had, but he brought us up as agnostics, so the thing has never been a worry or an agony, as it was to people who lost their faith.
Do you think this is in some way affected the kind of philosophical problems which you've become come to be concerned with?
Oh, I think so, yes.
Can you think of any type of connection?
Well, I attacked a senior colleague once at some length for defending a highly professional technical argument called the ontological argument for the existence of God, but I don't remember that I was much interested in the question whether there was a God or not. I was interested in the the trickiness of the argument that he, following other precedents, was using. No, I don't think that had much to do with it.
I'm wondering if the fact that you were not from at all ever concerned with certain types of moral or spiritual questions, which obviously some people might be concerned with, might help to account for certain qualities, maybe what some people call abstract qualities, in the kinds of problem that you're dealing with.
Oh, I shouldn't have thought there was much connection there. After all, there's no philosopher, even down to the third-rate ones, who isn't concerned with abstract problems. You might define philosophical problems as, in a certain way, abstract problems.
Could you explain that a little bit more?
Well, if you like, take Socrates, who asks such questions and tried to answer them. What is it for a man to be just, or what is it for a man to be pious, or something like that? Now, these are questions about piety, justice, and so on, abstract questions. He wasn't wandering around the world trying to find out how many just men there were in Athens, or how many people there were who pretended to be pious but weren't. I'd say he was dealing with an abstract or conceptual question and trying to answer it. And if he hadn't been doing that, he wouldn't have been doing philosophy, but something else. But of course, Socrates, like anybody else, was interested in a lot of other things as well. I mean, he was interested in his dinner when he was hungry. Doubtless he was interested in the fate of a battle when he was engaged in the battle as a soldier. and so on. And nobody has only one interest.
But you're convinced that in asking what is a just man, he was only asking an abstract question?
Well, anyhow, so I have no evidence that he was interested in anything else at that time. Thank you.